All right, we are beginning day two of the Fake Symposium. Thank you all for coming. Thank you all for finding the different room. Hopefully you didn't have to explore all of our signage in the old room to tell you how to get to the new room, and you just made it right here. As we talked about yesterday, this is a day full of exploring the boundaries between what is real and what is fake. We have two great panels and one great chat coming up today. We are running them pretty close to back to back. We'll do a little lunch break between the second panel and the third. If you're wondering, you know, you started at 10:30. Why didn't you just start at 9:30 or 9, and then you'd have much more room between panels? The answer is, we live in a society, and everyone must do their part, including starting an event at 10:30 instead of 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning. So I want to turn everything over to the fake IP panel. Thank you.
Okay. Can everyone hear me? All right. Good morning. And thank you for coming. I know sometimes the second day you get up and you got to motivate, so I appreciate that. And there's definitely still, I believe, Stars coffee outside if anyone needs any caffeine stimulation. I'm Jason Schultz. I'm a clinical professor here and part of the Engeberg Center. And I'm very excited about this panel because for those of us who are obsessed or fixated in any way on what is called intellectual property, the idea of what is real about it or fake about it is something I think is ever present in the sense of there are lots of assertions about what is real and what isn't, and then there's the realities that we try to look at in terms of not only what people think they own, but also what they think they can do to stop other people from doing things with what they think they own. So with that, we're going to have, I'm going to start off the panel. I'm going to let people introduce themselves. I'm going to start off by asking the sort of general question or provocation, and then we're going to have people go in order of just giving about 5 minutes or so of their response to that, and then we'll talk a little bit amongst ourselves, and then we'll involve all of you, hopefully, after that. So the provocation that I told the panel in advance is, tell me something fake about intellectual property, and then tell me something real about intellectual property. And so with that, we'll start with Stephen.
Appreciate it. Starting my stopwatch because I'm going to hold it to 5. I'm Stephen Lee. I'm Chief IP Counsel at Target. I've been there. Last week was my 19th year anniversary. Prior to that, I was at 2 different law firms for 4 years each. So I've been doing this for a little while. But the last 5 years have probably been the most interesting in terms of real and fake, and I think that's why they recruited me to be here, and I've been intimidated ever since I've sat through this conference. It's a very different type of legal conference that I haven't seen in a while. But I'm going to start first with the real side. I hope you know what Target is, but just in case, we're a discount retailer in every state in the United States. We're at all 50 states. We finally got into Vermont. Because we have a small format store there, and so it's not anti-big box anymore. So we made that. So we're in all 50 states. The last 5 years, again, not assuming you're a Target shopper, which you don't have to be, we have been launching own brands, private label brands, for the last 5-6 years, kind of hand over fist. We've launched about 50 of those own brands. And to give you a little context, this is not your seasonal holiday, Halloween brand. My team takes care of that as well. An own brand for Target probably is about $300 million to a couple billion dollars in revenue. So think about it. The last 5 years, we've been launching businesses, $1 billion at a time, sometimes some multi-billion dollar programs. And this is an example of some of the brands that we have launched these last couple of years. There's actually 2 more slides I could have put in for the sake of time. Not bragging or anything, but we've been doing a lot of filing, right? That amounts to a lot of different filings at the USPTO. So for the last 3 years, we've been either number one in the United States of domestic companies filing trademark applications in the USPTO, and probably top 10 worldwide because we protect our brands worldwide as well. So let me tell you a story about a real and a fake, because that was the prompt for us, right? So we were looking at launching a sportswear line, and we were considering a brand like most companies do. Hundreds of people involved, thousands of names that were screening, and one of them was Algo. We thought, oh, that's pretty, we wanted an Algo mark. It kind of was cool. It had a name to it. You know how marketing people are. And so we started searching that, and we ran into another mark called Algo B, right, on the register. It was published for opposition, meaning it was soon to be registered. And it would certainly have blocked us. It was exactly in class 25, which is the clothing class. It had a laundry list of items just like we would have had. And so we did our standard investigation. This was about October that we started looking into this AlgoBee. And this is the actual trademark specimen at the PTO. We did the investigation. We looked into it. Turns out we couldn't find the company. It was a Chinese company. The address didn't lead anywhere. The telephone number didn't go anywhere. The email address went nowhere. We hired a private investigator on the ground in China to investigate, and the best we could do was got some telephone number that listed some filing house, which we contacted, and they never heard of this registrant. Why were we contacting them? Because this was a use-based application that we were going to buy, right? If we can't clear over it, we purchased the rights. This company would have gotten rich, right, beyond measure, to get out of our way. But instead, we had to move on. We didn't have time, couldn't find anybody to pay off to buy their rights, and we moved on to another mark, which is now all in motion if you shop at Target. Turns out, we stumbled onto something that other people had started realizing and reading about. This was a fake trademark, a fraudulent trademark application. There was no company. If you could really zoom in on the box, do any kind of forensics on it, it's photoshopped on top of the box. They grab a box, they put a mark on top of it, they may offer that as a specimen, they may offer an Amazon web marketplace kind of ad, and they file not intent to use, but use-based, that claiming they are using this brand on every item listed in their single-class trademark application. We knew we were onto a problem, and these are just some statistics that I'll just blip through for you. This is the growth rate of Chinese applications, these type of Chinese applications, since the year about 2014. There's been a 2,700% increase in filings coming out of China. Just between, I think the year it says, between 2019, 2021, 222% increase. I thought in 2020 we hit the high water mark, but we didn't. 2021, about 176,000 of these applications are flooding the register, cluttering the register, and the bottom line is I think, if not all, a vast majority of them are not real. There is no product, there is not a product line associated with them. These are fake marks that are out there on the register, and what do? They block me, Target. Well, we're a big company, we can handle it. But they block everyday inventors, right? This is a company that is blood, sweat, and tears at the smallest level, seeking a trademark, and they see this Chinese registration. They don't know what they're looking at. And their lawyer says, you gotta move on, right? Find something else. All of that is either gone or they have to start over. It's a terrible problem that we're seeing. In fact, 2020 to 2021, the growth of applications, like coming out of COVID, right? Domestically in the United States, applications, which you would think would start peaking up, 25%. Foreign, up about 21%. And foreign also includes Hong Kong. So not sure if that's really China as well. But look at the Chinese number, 365%. Wow. They're innovative. They're entrepreneurial. Well, at least that's what they want you to think. What does this mean for you and me? Well, if you know anything, and this is why this has garnered more attention of late, because the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office is realizing the pendency of a trademark application is inordinately long, right? So you file your trademark application, it would typically be 2 or 3 months before you got to an examiner. You're staring at about 10 to 12 months now before the file even gets to an examiner. Why? Because you've got nearly 500, 800,000 applications in the pipeline. And a vast majority of them, they're getting jammed because of all the backlog of these Chinese applications, single-class, use-based applications coming out of China. On top of that, these Chinese applications, red line is Chinese applications, blue line is U.S. applications, a lot more effective at getting it to registration. They figured out the system. They file, and you've seen some of these, marks that have make no sense, random letters or numbers, and claim to be a trademark, right? A source identifier. And they're at least 10 times more successful than traditional U.S. trademark applications. They don't get office action issued against them. Here's an example, right? Stock photography, so easy. Right-click on Google. This is Ugerlove, a trademark registered at the Patent and Trademark Office. You click it, and you can see there's bags everywhere. All they do is superimpose, use that as a specimen, set up an Alibaba, Amazon marketplace, and you've got a specimen, ready-made, use-based, simply based on fraud. Here's another one. This is a camera. It was for a mark. Again, all of these cleared examinations. The mark here was Husen, right? For a digital camera. Looks really good. Problem is, it's actually a Logitech camera that they've just taken the brand off of it. And side by side, they just superimpose their brand and claim to be selling those items. You find fake labels or hang tags, all you have to do is have a dot matrix printer, print a tag, attach it to things, and you can see other brands on products when they rebrand their items. And so these are traditional items of toys, hard goods, kitchen kitchen items, et cetera, that are coming out of China, and clothing. And of course, that is Target's sweet spot. Here's a filing. Don't expect you to read it. This is showing you the mass filers. 2020, the numbers, I think it's 2020, the top filers, U.S. attorneys. So in 2019, the USPTO said, here's a solution. We're going to require all foreign applicants to have a U.S. attorney represent them. Should stem the tide of the problem. No. In fact, it encouraged the problem. So this is a filing. This is U.S. government, their own reports at the PTO. 2020, the number of applications, the top U.S. attorney filers in the United States. Okay? Let me zoom into the top 20. You're not going to... Jonathan G. Morton. Well, you should know him if you're in the trademark realm. He just got reprimanded by the PTO for mass filings, and he was suspended for 2 years. He admitted nothing doing anything wrong, even though in one day, in September 2020, he filed a trademark application every 7 minutes for 24 hours straight. In a span of a week, he filed one application every 12 minutes for 7 days a week, every hour of every day for that year. And he said this in front of the PTO, I'm just good. I'm just good at what I do. If you want to look further down the list, some names that you would recognize, number 32 would be Greenberg Traurig, big firm, right? Their application count was 1,590. The next U.S. firm, Barnes & Thornburg at 38, 1,244. Jonathan Morton, 21,000 applications, and he has some yellow there, and that yellow could be Hong Kong. I don't know where that's coming from. Since 2019, here's some hockey sticks. I'm from Minnesota, right? 2019, look at these practices that just started booming all of a sudden in trademark. These are non-IP attorneys for the most part filing trademark applications. It has just massively grown. Last thing, this is going to sound like a bar joke. Imagine December of 2020, 18 different clients walk into Jonathan Morton's office. 18 different clients walk in and ask him individually to file four-letter marks. These are the applications these 18 clients walked into his office and asked him to file that day. Oh, but surprise, surprise, all of them have the same identical listing of goods on their application, and these are their specimens of what they do. 18 different clients on the same day, identical goods, all of them cleared registration, right? That's the problem we're talking about. Is it just a Target problem? Certainly not. But currently, if you know trademark laws, we have about 60 this year oppositions and cancellations that we're in the process of filing. I mean, we filed them, so we have 60 ongoing actions. Can we afford it? Sure. Is it a pain? Absolutely. What happens with them? They default. They don't care. Basically, you're asking what the reason is for that. I could go on and on. I want to keep it to time, but they're at a very base level, and this has all been substantiated. The regional governments in China are paying about $1,000 to $1,500 per foreign registration that you secure. So think about it, $1,000 to $1,500 per, when the average income, middle-high income in China is $1,800 a month. They're making a killing off of this stuff, and it's cluttering, it's crippling our system, it's making it go incredibly slow, and I can tell you all the other reasons of why I think they do it. I can read into it, but I'll take a pause at this point.
All right, thanks, Stevie. We'll talk more about this. I'm just a little sad that I didn't get to register IP Speedy. That was my favorite one. I missed that chance, dang. All right, so now we're going to switch to Scott.
Hi, everyone. My name's Scott Hemphill. I'm a faculty member here at NYU, co-director of the Engeberg Center. It's a pleasure to get to see you all and be at an in-person conference and be on the panel with such a great set of colleagues. So I want to talk a little bit about the Coca-Cola bottle. So in a conference about what's real and what's fake, something that's often been described by the company itself as the real thing seemed like kind of an apt place to start. As will be familiar to us as consumers and to some of us as IP practitioners and scholars, the Coca-Cola bottle is famous, paradigmatic. It's the example that we go to when we teach, when Supreme Court justices talk about paradigmatic trade dress, that curvy bottle. You know, is stuck in our head. Warhol used it repeatedly. It was part of, I guess, a sort of three-legged stool, has been for a long time, that the Coca-Cola company relies on. You could say the bottle, the name itself, the secret formula, if in fact it is still secret, which is probably subject to its own real versus fake hour in itself. In work with Jake Gerson, a friend and colleague up at Harvard, we've done a little bit of work trying to kind of recover the early history of the Coca-Cola bottle back in the early days. Since we've recently celebrated a century of life with this bottle, we're kind of curious about the early days, how it became this paradigmatic vessel for investing, filling with efforts of marketing and consumer association, because the consumer association between the bottle itself and its source is sort of central to its protectability. And what we found, honestly, to our surprise, was as strong and unanswerable as it seems today, and perhaps is today, the origins are actually kind of murky and kind of fragile, and honestly, to follow the prompt, a bit fake. I'm not going to try to play out the whole story here, but fakeness, I think, arose in two different senses. First, the company, the Coca-Cola company, got a series of design patents. Not just one design patent, but three design patents covering the bottle over time. The first of which covered the prototype rather than the production bottle. And so depending on how narrow or broad you think design patents are, and I think we think they're narrow, and back then they thought they were narrow too, they probably didn't cover the production bottle. Now, given narrowness, maybe you could have gotten a fresh design patent on the production bottle. But they didn't do that. They actually waited 4 or 5 years to patent something extremely similar to the production bottle, leaving them in this awkward position of perhaps not being able to prevent a copyist who decided to use, had they done, the exact design of the bottle from doing so. They might not have been able to block exact copies. They made their life worse, moreover, by suing another soda company that, do you actually mind going down to the next one? Suing the Whistle Company, which also had a curvy bottle, not identical, and took it to trial and lost at trial in an opinion that some folks here will know that basically said, if you had a patent at all on your curvy bottle, a design patent, whatever it is that it's protecting is not the curviness itself in light of prior art. Can you go down one more? There were a lot of curvy bottles in the prior art. And so if you have a patent at all, it is really narrow. Now, before this ruling happened, second chair at trial, we went through the transcript, second chair at trial for the Coca-Cola company says, well, Your Honor, on your view that this patent is extremely narrow, that would mean we couldn't even prevent copies of the production bottle. So they understood at the time this potential implication of the narrowness of their bottle. The later bottle, the later patent, of course, could not have taken from the prior art the production bottle, right? Their belated patenting 4 or 5 years later could not have taken out of the prior art the ability of copyists to copy if they'd wanted to. So fake in the sense that it probably didn't cover the production bottle. Fake in the further sense that nevertheless you have a great deal of bluster and confidence, right? The company collects all its settlements against rivals in this three-volume tome grandly titled Opinions, Orders, Injunctions, and Decrees Relating to Unfair Competition and Infringement of Trademark. They put on the spine a famous quote from Justice Holmes in a trademark case that Coca-Cola Company had won in, I want to say, 1919, early 1920s. But all of this fakery does lead someplace real, to pick up the other piece of the prompt, because design patents are just kind of the first step, right, in a sort of quest for global domination. Ultimately, what you really want, what the main event is trade dress protection. Now, back in the day, unfair competition law is what we were using, right? Our modern gloss of trade dress is closely related to the early unfair competition. Then, as now, you needed secondary meaning. That is, you needed that consumer association between vessel and source that we understand to be so central today in trade dress. So there's a sense here of kind of faking it till you make it, right? They faked it till they made it. They pressed vigorously these design patent claims against other companies, not just the whistle company, but some that were really just engaged in probably copycat work. But then over time, they in fact did invest it with this consumer association, with this secondary meaning that made them a success from the standpoint of unfair competition and, of course, later trade dress. So that's the sense in which it was fake, but it became something real.
All right, thanks, Scott. All right, next up we have Brian Frye.
Hi, I'm Brian Frye. I'm the Dogecoin Professor of Law and Grifting at the University of Kentucky College of Law. And I start with a rhyme as I enter your mind. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. The original is something imaginary. There's nothing new under the sun. There's a total inversion of the relationship between original and copy. Thank you. Or the difference between original and copy vanishes altogether. Instead of a difference between original and copy, there appears a difference between old and new. We could even say that the copy is more original than the original, or the copy is closer to the original than the original. We might also say that originals preserve themselves through copies. But suppose copying is what makes us human, what then? More than that, what if copying, rather than being an aberration or a mistake or a crime, is a fundamental condition or requirement for anything, human or not, to exist at all? Writing is a dance that involves imitation, inspiration, and originality. But all things considered, writerly disapproval of plagiarism has remained remarkably consistent over the centuries, really even over millennia. In academia, the immorality of plagiarism is one of the few principles everyone converges on. Tilting at the plagiarism windmill seems a worthy quest. We all need something to do before the night comes. If academics were more concerned about spreading ideas than rewarding authors, plagiarism would not be the moral panic that it is today. But of course, academia is not simply about efficiently producing knowledge as a public good, but about properly crediting the producers. Drawing from these sources as if draining water from springs and fitting them to my own purposes, I find my command of writing made more fluent and easy. And trusting in such authors, I set about to compose new teachings. Thus, since I saw that such beginnings on their part were laid out for my planned undertaking, I set out to progress further by taking from them. Let us not mince words. The marvelous is always beautiful. Anything marvelous is beautiful. In fact, only the marvelous is beautiful. I have only made up a bunch of other men's flowers, pretending my own, only the string that ties them together, providing only my own. This is what constitutes their melancholy, incomparable beauty. Do not all the bold descriptions we have given amount to the definition of prayer? What art has been granted a dream more poetical and more real at the same time? Only the most high-minded persons, in the most perfect and mysterious moments of their lives, should be allowed to enter its ambience. If this is plagiarism, we'd need more plagiarism. Gosh, I wish I could do it all over.
Fantastic. All right. And then finally, Rebecca.
I always love speaking with Brian. That's just such a delight. I just want to go on record as saying I was supposed to be the fake panelist on this, and then somebody added me to the real program. So I became the fake panelist, which is about as meta as I like it to go, but also exactly what I would expect from this crew. And I just want to acknowledge as well that I'm drawing on work that I prepared on the lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nations in Annam, you know, is Melbourne, where sovereignty was never ceded. I'm going to talk about fake ideas about why we grant copyrights, because they're really dangerous. And that's because they lead directly to laws that harm creators and also disappear knowledge and culture. So copyrights, which protect expression, last far longer than patents, for example, which protect ideas. And the justification is that copyright is not just about incentivizing those necessary investments in getting works produced and then available ongoing. If it did have that purely economic motivation, then it wouldn't justify terms longer than about 25 years, for reasons I've written about elsewhere but will not bore you with here. Patents, which are seen as more limited to economic rationales, do have much shorter terms for that reason. But then when it comes to copyright, there's this additional motivation to recognize and reward creators. And that's what's used to justify things like copyright terms that far exceed the necessary amount to achieve those incentives. Now, some might argue, well, that doesn't really happen in the US because we've got this constitutional framing that you don't know about as an Australian, but I do. And people like Jane Ginsburg have really persuasively demonstrated that those sort of suspiciously continental natural rights rationales have very strongly influenced both lawmakers and courts in the development of copyright here as well. And in fact, every country, and it's happened in the other direction too, every country is some mix of economic and naturalist motivations for copyright. But certainly, I think we can all agree that those claims, those moral claims in favor of creators are used all the time by those lobbying to expand copyright rights. But this idea that copyright is about incentives and rewards is fake. Stafford Beer tells us that the purpose of a system is what it does. So what does the copyright system do? What's real here? All right, so what we see is that with a few sort of small exceptions, we have in common law countries grants of upfront lump sum awards that are usually fully alienable or almost entirely alienable, that can be taken from creators before anybody knows what they're worth, with no obligation to pay them fairly, and with no obligation for those rights holders to continue exploiting those works. The consequence of this, we have massive problems with creators getting paid. Like nearly all of the value of copyrights gets siphoned off at other points of the value chain. The value of creative labor goes to almost everybody except the creative laborer. And we have the loss of enormous amounts of knowledge and culture that are orphaned because the rights far outlast the rights holder's commercial interest. So, I mean, if copyright really was about incentivizing production and access and rewarding creators, boy, is it doing a terrible job. But what if that's just a convenient mythology? The brilliant Peter Drahosh gave one answer at the turn of the century about what copyright's really about. And I'm going to read straight from what he said. Financier's copyright is the third distinct view of copyright. It rests on the view that copyright must serve the financier of copyright works by guaranteeing rights of exploitation in whichever markets the financier chooses to operate. If new technologies like the internet come along to threaten existing investments or make new forms of exploitation possible, then the financier is entitled to new rights that allow him or her to manage the contingencies of the technology. Copyright becomes the servant of the financier rather than the author or the public welfare. So I was thinking about this last night. It popped into my mind when I was trying to decide what I wanted to talk about today, since I had to create a real presentation. And two decades on, looking at copyright's winners and losers and how they've evolved over that time, I think we might take a broader view that the real purpose of copyright is to act as the servant of big business. And there's many ways that we see it doing that for tech platforms, including in music streaming by creating these licensing thickets that make it incredibly difficult for new entrants into the market, which is why we're stuck with a small handful of streaming platforms, which are Spotify and owned by big tech. In video, we see it with even with the European DSM's Directive of New Liability Rules for Platforms, which nobody but YouTube can afford to comply with, meaning we just have YouTube. And what I was thinking is that, well, actually, maybe we were a little too zoomed in 20 years ago, and that copyright was always the servant of big business. It's just we didn't notice it so clearly because it was usually big business industries was those financiers of copyright. But this would explain things like this bizarre situation you have in this country where the big radio has managed to defeat every one of the dozens of bills that have ever tried to make creators get paid for the airplay of songs on radio, right? You are, by the way, in an exclusive club with Iraq, Rwanda, and North Korea on that one. And it would also help explain things like why the termination rights that were supposed to apply automatically after 25 years after transfer when they were first proposed. I've read the transcripts around how that particular legislative sausage got made, and the lobbyists there were very upfront about what they were trying to achieve there, and they successfully managed to get those altered to the point that they are virtually unused. So I'm going to leave it with that, but I do want to say I do think that our current ways of conceptualizing copyright as being, sure, they're about incentives, they're about rewarding creators, camouflage what's really going on.
All right, thank you. And I just want to give a quick shout out that Rebecca and Cory Doctorow are going to be doing a fun time book party tonight at 7 p.m. So if you want to hear more about from her and Cory about and from their new book, it's happening just across the street.
Oh, and I should say as well, if you do come, we absolutely can't say you can bring drinks in. But like if you went to the bodega beforehand, it could be an even more fun time book party.
Exactly.
And if you've not ever heard Cory talk, it's a real treat.
So can I show that slide? No. So I have only one latent free writing contribution to make here, but I was sort of inspired to talk a little bit about actually a clinic project that my students and I did. So some of you may know this, but Michael Weinberg here, not only being the awesome executive director of our center, but also is the board president of the Open Source Hardware Association. And open source hardware is a big, giant, interesting community, but just recently, we had a project with them because in a very strange, and this sort of starts with Stephen's story here a little bit, but maybe even ties into the rest. They had run across 32 strange trademark applications that had been filed on components and various parts of electronics that were often very much used in open source hardware. And so you can sort of do the trademark analysis of all this, which we did, and you know that's the attorney-client privilege part. But basically, you know, trying to trademark the name of a component has its challenges. But what was also more interesting to me at the time, kind of from this fake IP point of view, was that the company that was trying to do it was this, it was MXP, right? That's it. Yeah, this Berlin-based startup that had received like almost $1 billion in funding from VCs to, and its business model, what it was getting all this money to do was to buy Amazon resellers. So this company, the startup in Berlin, who had been given all this money to buy Amazon resellers, and I assume sort of, you know, doing analytics on which resellers or which sort of, you know, affiliates were doing the best business on Amazon, was suddenly filing a bunch of trademark applications, and that sort of puzzled me, right? And so we did some poking around and talking to some people. And one of the things that I thought was sort of interesting about it that came up, I realized that Amazon actually offers an IP accelerator product, which I think is kind of the IP speedy made me think about this too, right? And essentially takes a cut referring you to vetted IP attorneys to help you get IP. And one of these things that I'm like, well, so, you know, okay, that's fine and all, but how does this all fit into the big picture? And we started looking into, oh, right, because they have a brand registry at Amazon. And if you're registered with a brand registry, you can get takedowns faster. And if your business is Amazon resellers who might need to take down competitors quickly, you might be interested in what trademark applications you could file for them on behalf of them that might help you get on the brand registry and that, you know, and sort of influence on some level various marketplaces that are essentially run by corporations, right? Completely internally with their own rules and their own submarkets. So anyway, so I just wanted to share this because I do think that there's a lot here. I don't understand or I can't explain all of it, but it does seem to me that there is quite a bit going on both within the traditional government institutions, but also within these platforms. And these marketplaces where a lot of gaming is going on and it's not as clear what the impact and effects are. But basically the end result is that MXP at some point for various reasons, just let the marks go too. So this also kind of goes back to some of the points of like, what are they in it for, which I think are sort of interesting. But with that, I wanna turn back to the panel here and just kind of, you know, open it up for conversation with each other, but also to, you know, pose the question, which, you know, I think is at least worth asking, which is, should we care about fake IP? Or, you know, it's something, I mean, what should be done about it, if anything, and can we actually do anything about it? I mean, there's this part of me that is wondering, like, you know, what is to be done, if anything here? So I'm just going to put that out there and see if anyone wants to jump in on the question.
I guess I'll start us. I mean, for this particular story that I was advancing about the Coca-Cola bottle, I think it's kind of mixed. There's a sense in which we should care, and then a sense in which caring about the fake part might be kind of missing the point at some level. So, you know, when we got started working on this, I found it extremely galling that they had what to our eye looks like quite possibly a fake assertion of design patents, that is, assertion of one patent that was probably not infringed and another that was probably invalid or in light of the prior art or in any event didn't read back on the prior art. This was read back on the production bottle. This was galling for reasons connected to something that Rebecca was talking about, how temporary protection is different. Patent protection is different from the more permanent, very long-lived copyright protection and the indefinite protection of trademark and trade dress. And so using that short-lived, that fake IP to kind of lever up permanent unfair competition protection, permanent trade dress protection, really kind of bothered me when I was first thinking about this. I learned to live a little bit with the fakeness of the design patents, though, because to me the bigger issue in retrospect is, well, the idea that we could render permanent using design patents trade dress indefinitely, that like, yes, these particular design patents may or may not have actually read on the production bottle ultimately, but that in this broader set of circumstances where the initial IP, let's all agree, is legitimate, let's agree that somebody got a design patent before secondary meaning developed, and then they use that to lever up design patent protection. This doesn't depend on the fakeness, just to be clear, right? That we could render this temporary into permanence, something that I take to be common ground among practitioners. I know Mark is in the audience, McKenna has written about this. Just thinking about this, I find this relatively outrageous. Now, it works for design patents. It doesn't work for utility patents. This was actually another moment of fragility for the Coca-Cola company back in the 20s and 30s. Because at the time that they were in a position to make this leap, some of the contemporaneous opinions, Shredded Wheat is an example, Singer maybe in an earlier time, were advancing a kind of quid pro quo. Once you've had your patent expire, it goes into the public domain and you can't lever up into permanence. And that idea applied not only for utility patents but also for design patents. One of the patents in Shredded Wheat is a design patent. But it just kind of gave way over time. You know, we sort of lost this thread in favor of a thread based on functionality, which successfully denies permanent protection for utility, for things covered by utility patents. Folks who think about the traffics case, this would be an example. But design patents went a different way. And so for me now, that's kind of, in some way, the big story. And so the fakeness feels like almost a distraction against that outrageous, but standard practice point, just to be clear. It is, I think, common ground these days under U.S. doctrine. If you've got a design patent and you want secondary meaning, go get the design patent as a way to shelter yourself in a fake it till you make it sort of way until you've achieved secondary meaning. Hopefully you can do that before the design patent expires, and then you're set. And this is a gambit that I think is quite troubling.
So I think these fake ideas about what copyright's about, which are particularly insofar as they're resulting in creators getting an ever-reducing share of the rewards of their work are hugely dangerous, and we do need to care about them. So what we're really seeing is we're seeing these choke point markets being created, right, where we've got audiences at one end, creators at the other, and then these sort of predatory corporations squatting at the neck, where they use their ability to mediate access between the two in order to shake down often both sides, but because of the way the consumer welfare standard works in antitrust, they're mostly shaking down their workers and suppliers, so that's on the creator end. We see this like increasingly everywhere. So we see it in music streaming, music publishing, music recording, right? The big three record labels control almost 70% of the global recorded music market, right? They use the power from those copyrights because they last so long, even though those labels are not essential anymore in order to get your music produced and available in the way that they used to be. The fact that they control that much means that they've got the power to shape the future of the industry. When we criticize Spotify and we criticize streaming and we say this doesn't work for artists, a lot of people forget that it's designed that way because that's how the majors mandated it to be designed, right? But we see these choke points about, you know, the book market, Amazon's control over physical books, ebooks, audiobooks, incredibly dangerous, because they are constantly arranging the rules to extract more and more of the share. And so yesterday, what happened yesterday was really incredible. I don't know if many of you followed the Twitch announcement. Twitch was acquired by Amazon a little ways back. And the rationale for that was to say, this will be fantastic because this behemoth Amazon, one of the things that it really benefits from is drastically reduced bandwidth costs. Bandwidth is the big cost for Twitch. And so, yay, this is going to be wonderful for creators. But of course, what actually panned out, and we said this in real time yesterday, is exactly what always happens. So they actually came out saying the quiet part out loud. They unilaterally said, okay, we're changing the terms on which we pay the most successful streamers on our website. You're not going to get 70% share anymore. You're going to get a 50% share. And the way this was paraphrased by Sam Biddle was, the way they explained it is that Amazon is charging Amazon so much money to run the business via Amazon that it has no choice but to take more money from streamers. And that was legit the explanation. Sorry, our bandwidth costs are so expensive, we can't pay you so much anymore, right? And Corey's got an amazing post from yesterday that you should read if you're interested about this. But that kind of shakedown is exactly what happens whenever you have the conditions that put so much power into these concentrated corporations. And the reason that they're able to achieve that in many, many cases when it comes to copyright is because we award it in this way, this sort of lump sum upfront, almost entirely alienable way that allows them to take everything, right? But obviously, if your kid is being shaken down at the school gate by bullies for their lunch money, they take the kids $5 every day, your kid comes home hungry, you don't fix that problem by giving them $10, right? But that's what we keep doing when we keep expanding copyright in ways that allow it to keep being taken away. And the danger is we go much further down this path. The kind of people that can afford to like professionally devote themselves to creativity are either the most commercial ones exclusively or the most privileged ones. That has a huge impact on the kinds of stories that we get to hear and the people who get to speak.
Why don't we take one more comment and then we'll go to...
The bees plunder the flowers here and there, but afterward they make of them honey, which is all theirs. Even so with the pieces borrowed from others, we must make them our own. Truth and reason are common to everyone, and no more belong to the man who first spoke them than to the man who says them later. He who receives an idea from me receives instruction himself without lessening mine, and he who lights his taper at mine receives light without darkening me.
Amazing. All right. So if folks have questions, I will go ahead. Why don't you introduce yourself?
I have a question for Professor Frye that's more of a comment. Professor Frye, everything in your talk was plagiarized. I recognize every word from something else that I've read elsewhere, so every sentence from something else I've read elsewhere. How do you justify stealing other people's words? How do you live with yourself?
I actually feel pretty good about it. It makes me happy doing it. I sleep well at night. You know, I really got tired writing this, you know, using my control C and control V fingers. There's a lot of work that went into it. And I borrow this stuff because I love it and I want to make it mine. And plagiarizing really is the truest form of love. You want it so badly that you want to take it and make it yours.
Oh my God!
And give it to more people. So I feel really great about this, actually. I want everyone to start plagiarizing more. We need to start teaching our students how to plagiarize well, because that's how law practice really is.
Other comments, questions? Yeah, there's sometimes trolls in the audience. Yeah. I'm sorry about that. I'll make one additional comment, which is I actually, in clinical work, we actually often do talk about control C, control V, because, you know, it's this thing where in law school, there's this emphasis on, you know, not doing that, which I think is misleading for the practice of law, absolutely. So, I mean, you have to reformulate it in the context of your client, but why reinvent the wheel is a definite central piece of what we do.
Yeah, no, absolutely. There is such a disconnect, I think, between what we tell our students to do, right, and then our own practice. We're putting together a grant application. We are like, you know, and like, I think we do a lot more of that in Australia, maybe, and they're like super annoying and technical, but you like get all your friends to send you theirs and then you just like shamelessly crib from it, right? Because it's just dumb to reinvent the wheel on that. I think we need to acknowledge more of that, and I think the idea of getting our students to plagiarize well, like, aren't what we really objecting to is how badly they do it in a lot of cases. Because, you know, where is the line? I think it's a really interesting question and one we should think about a little bit more carefully.
There's so much that they could learn from their professors and reading their legal scholarship too, because so many of us law professors, all we do is write the same paper over and over again anyway. So, I mean, you know, what's the big deal? You just hash it over and over again.
Brian spent the whole summer writing the paper for this with every single word plagiarized, which I think is a rod for his own back. I spent 20 minutes last night in my Airbnb going, I think I maybe this idea I had before, but I think it kind of links to this other idea I had before. I'm pulling open a bunch of documents, and I wasn't such a purist as he is, but yeah, there's a lot of pastiche and development that way as well. But you know, in the course of doing that, I did feel I had this new idea when I remembered what Drahash had written about financiers' copyright. It got me really excited because I hadn't looked at that again for a little while, and it linked into some other new stuff I've done since. And I'm super excited about this new direction that I want to take these ideas. And I wouldn't have got there if I hadn't plagiarized my own stuff last night in that 20 minutes.
Yeah, over there. Oh, can you turn on the mic if it's possible?
Stephen, do you think trademark examiners should and can look more closely at submitted specimens?
Yeah, we've had extensive discussions both on Capitol Hill with the director, commissioner, about what I think Target's ideas would be, right? I mean, the example we give them is if Target has an issue of gift card fraud, we don't expect each cashier to be able to identify it, right? That's putting it the wrong place. I mean, every cashier, oh, I'm not sure if this is legit or not. We do think there's a role for the cashier or the examiner, but anytime Target has an issue, we come in at it three ways, right? People, processes, and technology. Got to train the people correctly. We need the examiners to examine correctly, give them the tools that they need to look at this. And I think part of it is they've got such a diverse workforce. It used to be they're centralized, but now they're just working out of their homes all over. There's not a lot of review. There's no one to go to when they literally have a question. And aside, this is not answering your question, but a side issue of this is all this fakery, what the impact, it's going to have an impact at the PTO, right? They're self-funded. They are hiring up like crazy to staff examiners. But do you see any of these fraudulent applications? They will not file 8 and 15s and pay their fees. They will not renew. So you're staffing up enormously to have all these examiners, and when it dries up, if and when it dries up, you funded it, and you have all these people sitting around and not doing anything. So It's going to cripple the system in that way as well. But truly, we say people, processes, right? There's got to be a better way. Pull these pre-examination. I can give you 8 or 9 telltale signs of a fraudulent application. Pull them before they even get to examination. Ask the right questions. Make them respond, because if you issue even a preliminary office action, they will not respond. They'll go away. And the PTO will have their fees. They'll get their payment, but they'll just abandon because they'll move on to their next target or whatever else they're going to do. People, processes, and technology. The technology at the PTO honestly needs to get better. It's not, I mean, right click and you get a Google Images, you can find it. There's much more sophisticated forensic tools that you can identify fraudulent applications. It's not that hard. I can do it, and yet it's skating through. They're getting through in enormous numbers. They're not getting rejected. So all three, it really needs to be three-pronged. It's not legislative. It's really just the will to do it, the resources to do it as well.
We're going to take one more question in the back. Back there, yeah.
Thanks for this great panel. I am a bit of the oddball in so much I'm a modern art historian that stumbled into intellectual property, and specifically, among other things, the Coca-Cola bottle. So I love this presentation, and it seems to me that your fake it till you make it model is true not only of the design patent turned one of the very first U.S. Trademarks for a container in the Coca-Cola bottle, but it's true of almost all of Coca-Cola's trademarks. They're all deeply flawed until they become the most recognizable trademarks in the world. So I think the history that you're laying out, you're hinting at, is utterly accurate. What I've, in my own research, what has surprised me as a foil, though, is another model, in this case the French model, in which is the trademark model goes back even further to 1857 and is long established before Coca-Cola is dealing with any of these. And in the French model, there's no problem with patent trademarking forms, colors, shapes, containers. All of these things are debated, but mostly ultimately granted. And what I also, like you, find abhorrent in the fake it till you make it, you can patent trade, you can patent the design until you get secondary meaning and then get a trademark for all eternity. The French were successful in developing an alternate model. And I'm wondering if you've done any comparative research on the US and the Coca-Cola and how things went completely off the rails there versus other trademark systems which have managed a little bit more stability. I mean, the French model, that 1857 model got junked in the 1960s, so it was no longer effective. But for a long time, that model was an alternative to the US model. And I'm wondering if you've engaged in any comparatives, because yes, I agree with you, the US model failed, but it also, and now dominates, but it wasn't the only model at the time.
That's terrific. I'd love to talk more offline. The short answer is no, we've done no comparative work. The longer answer is a little bit.
Just fake it, man.
A
just
little
fake
bit.
It.
To the extent that, in Europe, there's been some litigation around a revision of the bottle. So maintaining the shape that you can see small on the sides of the Coke bottle, probably the Diet Coke also, the cans rather, where it's the silhouette or a modification of the silhouette, but without the ridges or ripples, depending on who you ask. And could you claim that as a trade dress shape? And Europe was hostile to that. And so we've explored that a bit, in part to look for U.S. analogies, so a kind of not a very powerful comparative approach, I admit. We do spend a little bit of time on the name to the extent that Coca-Cola itself has a kind of deceptive misdescription thing going, right? Because by the time that was getting litigated in the U.S., they'd taken cocaine out of the product, and so Coca wasn't true, and cola for the cola nut was only present in trace amounts. They were caught in a funny vice in the U.S. because the FDA came after them on pure food and drug grounds for not correctly describing their product. They settled that, but it helped reveal the vulnerability that they had when Coke, K-O-K-E, they wanted to prevent from marketing under that name, and the K-O-K-E Coke said, well, you guys have unclean hands with your deceptive misdescription. And so the Holmes quotation, which I'm going to slightly botch, you know, well known, that Coca-Cola is a name well known to the community as a source designator. This was their big victory, was that secondary meaning had attached and hence trumped, notwithstanding the kind of deceptive misdescription burbling below the surface. So we spend a little bit of time on that in the chapter, but I mean, it's a very fascinating, rich history that we only capture part of.
Thanks, Scott. All right, well, I think we'll, for purposes of staying on time, we're going to end there, but please join me in thanking all the panelists, real and fake.